Would you guess that the use of histograms for graphical analysis is mostly irrelevant? Let's see an example how a manufacturing company wasted a substantial amount of money due to an inappropriate use of histograms. A producer of diesel injection components was using a small 5-pallet conveyor system to transport the nozzle needle to one of the grinding operations. This grinding operation was substantial to the final lapping operation, but the measurement indicated an excessive variation in the critical dimension. It was suspected that the excessive variation was due to a variable positioning in the pallet, which induced a variable positioning in the collet. If this is so, the process would exhibit a multimodal behavior reflecting the different properties of the 5 pallets. And this was exactly what the manufacturing experts found on the histogram. Based on this, a decision was made to change the 5-pallet conveying system to a robotic manipulator at a considerable cost. But surprisingly, this had no effect to the overall variation. The histogram just assumed a different shape. So what is the problem now? Should we change the conveying system again? To understand what the problem is, we must first understand what the histogram is. Histograms are often used for graphical analysis of the distribution's properties. In many textbooks, and especially in the Six Sigma literature, you will find guides on how to read it. You are expected to see the center, variation, and shape of your data. You should identify abnormalities, asymmetries, see if the distribution looks normal, if it is unimodal, bimodal, or multimodal, and much more. Well, let's put these claims to test. The histogram is a graphical representation of tabulated frequencies shown as adjacent bars graphed over a specified interval. The height of the bars is proportional to the count of the observations in the respective interval. The total area under the histogram equals the number of all observations, or when normalized to proportions, the total area equals 1. This is easily done just by dividing the count in the bins by the number of all observations. The histogram now becomes an approximation of the probability density function of the distribution, so we should see the claimed properties. But before we actually draw the histogram, we must select the size of the bins and where they should start. There is not an optimal size of the bin. In fact, you can find many different opinions and formulas for this, and it is only a matter of preference where the first bin starts. Unfortunately, for the usual sample sizes, the histograms are pretty sensitive to both. To make matters worse, some of the formulas were standardized internationally, leading to over-reliance on them in the industry. Let's take 60 data points randomly sampled from a normal distribution. Making the histogram on 60 data points is not at all unusual. It is in fact very generous for most of the real Six Sigma applications. This animation shows how the shape of the histogram changes if we change the bin size or if we change the starting point. You can see how completely different the images are and how completely different the conclusions about the distribution properties would be. It is only a matter of pure chance to conclude that there are outliers, that the distribution is normal, that it is skewed, or that it is multimodal. So are the histograms completely useless? Well, the shape of the histogram will become robust to these problems as the number of observations increases,
but we would be talking about hundreds or thousands of data points. Only then the histogram is a decent approximation of the probability density function, which we actually need to read the claimed properties. In their usual applications, the histograms are only good when we know where the boundaries of the bins should be. The boundaries of the bins should have technical reasons. They should not be dependent on the data alone. The boundaries may, for example, represent the tolerances of the dimension we measured, or they could be the control boundaries, or they could be the measurement uncertainty.
But they always have to be connected to the technical phenomena that accompany the problem for which we are analyzing the data. We also should not limit ourselves to equal bin widths. The bins can be of any width as long as they are adjacent. When constructed so, the interpretations of the histogram are quite different.
We can forget about recognizing the shapes, modes, and outliers, but now we can see how frequently the data accumulates at intervals that are more favorable or less favorable to our processes in order to take appropriate action.
But what if we want to know the shape of the distribution, recognize the modes, or see if it is skewed? Are there any alternatives to the histogram for the usual sample sizes? One quite useful method is the kernel density estimation. It still requires some assumptions about the kernel shape and size, but it is notably less sensitive to assumptions compared to the histograms.
The kernel density estimation produces a smooth probability density function, which more accurately reflects the distribution of the variable we have. Let's get back to our poor nozzle needle producer.
When the kernel estimate is used to picture the nozzle needle data, it becomes clear that what seem to be the modes are just random clusters of data, and the shape of the distribution is actually almost the same before and after the expensive conveyor system change. If the manufacturing engineers had used this form of information before, they would never have proceeded with the change of the conveyor. The shape of the distribution does not correspond to the pallet hypothesis. After a little more investigation, it was found that the excessive variation was due to a spindle vibration at one specific frequency, but the damage was done. The histogram misled the team and caused the company to waste their time and resources. Please remember that the data analysis is here to transform data to information which is perceptible and interpretable by people who use it. Interpreting the information requires an expert knowledge on one side, an appropriate information quality on the other, but most of all, a mutual understanding of what the information will be used for.